Worship God together as we get to hear each other's voices as we sing and also receive the word together as we listen and both apply it through our ears but also to our hearts and have the opportunity also as we pray. We do all these things in striving to carry out our mission, the Great Commission as a local church to make disciples of Jesus Christ who love God and who love the people around us. And I trust the service will be a blessing to all of us as we strive to glorify God that way together this morning. Also, I'd like to offer a warm welcome any new guests or visitors we have here with us today. We trust the service will also be a blessing to you as we worship together for these reasons. But also, we encourage you to stop by the welcome kiosk in the foyer right after the service as one of the pastors will be there. And we'd love to get to know you a little bit better if you have the time to do that. Then in terms of our church family updates, I got a couple of reminders for you all today. First of all, we have an upcoming business meeting on May 19th at 6 p.m. I encourage you to mark your calendars with that. It's a few weeks out, but we want to make sure we don't miss that one. Also, there's a taco fellowship afterwards. I trust that will be an enjoyable time for all. And then a second thing to mark your calendars for is VBS this year is right around the corner. It is in July 8th through 12th. However, the signups are open right now for volunteer workers. I would encourage you to consider being a part of that and look out for the link either in the bulletin or your bits and bytes, or you can contact Rich Cork or Tiffany Mullins to sign up for that. I would encourage you to consider those things. For more great information about these or other upcoming events, as there's more than just those two, be sure as always to check out your bulletin or your bits and bytes to make sure you don't miss out on any of the things that are going on around Berean. Then in terms of our time of worship this morning, our sermon today is from Isaiah 42, and today we'll consider the comfort of a new song, the comfort of a new song. With that in mind, we're going to focus our songs this morning on joyfully singing our Redeemer's praise together. So at this time now, to prepare ourselves for our time of worship, I just ask we take a moment of silent reflection as an opportunity to quiet our hearts and repent of any sin as we come before our holy God together this morning. Hear God's word from Psalms chapter 121. It says, "The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore." Let's pray together.
Our Father and our God, we come before you this morning with hearts and minds that have been occupied with countless issues of life over this past week. And though we try to remember your presence and your truth in the midst of these things, our faith is often overwhelmed and exhausted, and our love too often begins to cool. And so we thank you, Father, for this holy Sabbath that calls us away to rest in your presence, to gaze upon your beauty, and to worship you in the one spirit that quickens and unites many hearts. You tell us to draw nigh to you, and you promise to draw nigh to us. You call us to come to you, Lord Jesus, and you promise to give us rest. And so, Father, fill us with the serenity of knowing that all the issues of life are in their proper place, under your sovereign control, and being managed by your compassionate heart. Fill us with the restful peace of knowing that we are redeemed citizens of another country, an eternal kingdom whose king has already conquered the enemies of our soul and the manifold stressors and pains of life. Fill us with the vision of your glory and your goodness, and may the selfish inclinations of our fleshly minds be forgotten. Refresh our faith and fortify it with your truth. Fill us with the love of your spirit, bind our hearts together with it, and receive it back from us as an offering to you, and draw it out of us to a world that doesn't know you. Awaken our gratitude for who Christ is and what he's done for us, so that our praise and worship may flow from our hearts more fully. And fill your servant with your spirit and minister your word to us through him. We pray all these things for the glory of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. All right, let's begin our time of singing together, joining our voices as we fix our eyes on the home we are living toward as God faithfully guides us to the end. Singing together, Almost Home. Let's stand as we sing together. So last week we sang together, I Lift My Eyes Up, which was an old but new to Berean song that I have been singing for many years, and it's built around the most famous part of Psalm 121, the paragraph that goes, I lift my eyes up to the mountains, where does my help come from? However, as I was reading in preparation to sing this, I was just saying there's just so much more content in the Psalms than just that paragraph. So I decided to add a second verse. We're going to sing for the first time today with a little bit more of that. I trust it will be a blessing together. So we'll sing it together now. I lift my eyes up with even more of Psalm 121 in it than last week. Let's sing together.
My help come from?
Let's now turn our attention to the Word of God as we read together from Psalms chapter 149, considering a new song to God. I'll begin, and you can join on the second part. It says, "Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the godly. Let Israel be glad in his Maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their King. Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with tambourine and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with salvation. Let the godly exalt in glory. Let them sing for joy on their beds." As we look to our sermon considering the comfort of a new song to God, let's joyfully now sing God's praise together as his chosen people, or continue to sing as we sing, "How Can I Keep From Singing Your Praise?"
I can see 'cause you hear me, Lord, when I call to you. I can see with my last breath, sing for I know that I'll see.
lastly, before we pray and hear God's word proclaimed this morning, let's continue singing together as is fitting for the redeemed people of God, singing, "I will sing of my Redeemer."
It's a joy to be here with you this morning, so join me together. So we knit our hearts together in prayer, inspired by the song of the prophet in Habakkuk chapter 3. O Yahweh, Creator God, we have heard the reports of you, and we stand speechless in awe. Your splendor covered the heavens, and all the earth praised you. Your brightness was like pure light. Rays flashed from your hand, and even then, you were restraining your power. You stood and measured the earth and looked and shook the nations. O God, you and you alone deserve the worship and praise of all creation. You are the utmost of all perfection, creative, holy, righteous, loving, merciful, and good. How can we stand before such majesty and beauty? You alone, O God, are from everlasting to everlasting. You are the only one with intrinsic self-existence and eternal in being. All else depends on you for its very existence. Even the most powerful rulers and powers and kingdoms would be undone in an instant and would cower in fear if you but showed a glimmer of your pure and glorious nature to them. Everything that is grand here on earth would shatter and would be humbled to lowliness. How can we stand before such purity and power? Not on our own merits or in our own strength, that is certain. You plainly tell us in Scripture that because of your infinite mercy and steadfast love, you sent your Son, Jesus the Messiah, perfectly holy, humble, and loving, to be the salvation of your people through his life, death, and resurrection. It is this gospel of Jesus the Anointed One that gives us any and all hope. This unimaginably valuable gift of everlasting life is given to us freely in spite of who we are. So we work here and around the globe to bring this message to others. The gospel of Jesus Christ is worth sharing. It's worth striving for. It's worth defending, and it is worth proclaiming to our neighbors here and all around the world. How can we keep from singing your praise? So we thank you for the efforts of so many laborers to bring the gospel message and the gospel power to the world. We pray for Jim and Marlena Rarick as they minister to the international students that have been drawn to our nation for their education. We ask that you bless Jim and Marlena with fruit, provision for their ministry, wisdom in making decisions, and through it all, a joy in their labors for the gospel. We ask similar blessings for local gospel preaching churches, and particularly this morning for Calvary Baptist Church in Canton. Give Pastor Riddle and their board of elders boldness and wisdom to proclaim truth and exemplify a Christ-centered ministry. And of course, we pray that you give all the many servants here at Berean the strength and fervor to continue their service well, especially Pastor Mark and his wife Becky, and Deacon Stephen and his wife Ruth and their families. We thank you for their faithfulness, the love of the brethren, and so much behind-the-scenes giving of time, energy, and resources to ensure that Berean stays a beacon of the gospel truth to everyone. O God, the world hears your voice and trembles. The enemies of truth and righteousness will be crushed with their own arrows. Rottenness will enter their bones. O God, without Christ, we are these enemies, and we would be crushed. But through faith in Jesus, you appointed us no longer to be your enemies, but to be your children. In Jesus, death and evil will meet their ultimate end. In Jesus, we have victory over the evil one, even in our daily trials here. And you have opened our eyes to spiritual truths and enable us to live, even today, more like Christ as you cleanse us and work in us to conform us to his image. Whether young or old, we need you. We need you, Father, to make us more like your Son. We are desperate for you to guide our steps in this walk. Though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. Father, we need you to continually uphold us in our walk. We pray for your guidance for our prayer families of the week, for Greg and Kelly Hovermail, as they desire good things for their family and seek to follow your will in service to King Jesus. Pray for Nicole Reinhardt as she continues her college path, desiring to serve you as she serves others. Pray for Sarah Robertson, that you give her joy and rest in your sovereign and loving hand, especially through trials. And we thank you so much for the joy that she has in her Christian friends. And we pray for Marquita Whitfield, that your goodness is seen and felt in her and in her beloved family. Give all these dear, beloved brothers and sisters opportunity to give your life-saving truth and wisdom, both in word and in deed, to those whom they alone can reach with the gospel. Give them joy in their service, knowing that your grand tapestry of history uses each one of us as an essential thread to make the complete and perfect and glorious picture for eternity. No life, whether long or short, is wasted. No prayer, whether public or private, goes unheard. Our brief lives here are filled with both trials and pleasures, but whether in ease or in pain, whether in satisfaction or in hunger, whether surrounded by friends or in isolation, we will take joy in the God of our salvation. Yahweh the Lord is our strength. He makes our feet solid on our path, and by his power we can follow the hard road of righteousness blazed by Jesus Christ. And this path will end one day. One day, your children will enter your glorious presence to our true home and to our eternal inheritance. Thank you for this blessed hope. Thank you for this salvation. I pray that we step into that day prepared. Prepared by wearing the pure, spotless, righteous robes earned by Christ and given by grace to those who surrender their lives to him. Father, prepare us now for today and for eternity through your perfect word given by your willing servant. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
The reading today is Isaiah 42:10-17. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise from the end of the earth. You who go down to the sea and all that fills it, the coastlands and their inhabitants. Let the desert and its cities lift up their voice, the villages that Kedar inhabits. Let the inhabitants of Selah sing for joy. Let them shout from the top of the mountains. Let them give glory to the Lord and declare his praise in the coastlands. The Lord goes out like a mighty man, like a man of war. He stirs up his zeal. He cries out. He shouts aloud. He shows himself mighty against his foes. For a long time, I have held my peace. I have kept still and restrained myself. Now I will cry out like a woman in labor. I will gasp and pant. I will lay waste mountains and hills and dry up all their vegetation. I will turn the rivers into islands and dry up the pools. I will lead the blind in a way that they do not know. In paths that they have not known, I will guide them. I will turn the darkness before them into light, the rough places into level ground. These are the things I do, and I do not forsake them. They are turned back and utterly put to shame who trust in carved idols, who say to metal images, you are our gods.
Well, thus far in the book of Isaiah, we have reached the fourth major division. We've entitled The Comfort of the Gospel, beginning in chapter 40 on through chapter 55. And we're examining nine specific comforts in that big section of Scripture. We have looked at three of these comforts: the comfort of God's glory in chapter 40, the comfort of God's sovereignty in chapter 41, and the comfort of the chosen servant in chapter 42, verses 1 through 9. Now, today we want to look at a fourth specific comfort. It is this: the comfort of a new song. You know, while singing might seem to be intuitive and a natural reflex in the hearts of people, people really need a reason to sing. We find reasons to sing. Sometimes we sing in commiseration with other people. We sing at funerals to help people grieve, to express our sorrow. In the old antebellum South, the Negro spirituals were rich with that commiseration as they commiserated the great burden of slavery and the hope that there was a better day coming in glory. They commiserated together, and their songs that they wrote and that they sing just emanate with that kind of ethic. Well, celebration, right, is a good reason to sing. We sing, happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you. There's another version of that song for somebody that's really old. It goes like this. Happy birthday, happy birthday. That's what they sing to me now because I'm so old. But we sing in celebration of our birthday. Can you believe that some idiot tried to copyright the birthday song here a few years ago? I don't know if you read that, but he tried to copyright the birthday song. So every time we sing it to our grandkids, we'd have to pay a royalty. Crazy. Well, we sing on New Year's Eve, right? Auld Lang Syne. What in the world does that mean? Auld Lang Syne is an old Scottish term meaning literally old long since, or for old time's sake. Given that, it kind of makes sense that that's a tradition on New Year's Eve. Communities will adopt a song when their sports team is really doing well. Some of you will remember 1968. To many of you, that is like, it might be 1768 as far as you're concerned. But 1968, the Detroit Tigers won the World Series. Here it is. This is the team that won the World Series. And somebody, I don't know who, started the song, you know, for the baseball team. We're all behind our baseball team. Go get them, Tigers. How many of you remember that? Yeah, a few of you, right? Great song. World Series bound and picking up steam. Yeah. Well, there are reasons to sing, and we need reasons to sing. There are just some occasions that call for a song. Well, chapter 42 of Isaiah is one of those occasions. In verse 10, we read this, sing to the Lord a new song, his praise to the ends of the earth. You know, God's people have always been a singing people. From Exodus 15 and the song of Moses just after the crossing of the Red Sea to the very last pages of Revelation, where we read in Revelation 15:3, and they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord God, the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. In between those two references, there are some 200 songs to be found in the Bible. There's an entire book, the book of Psalms, that served as the Hebrew hymnal. And while their singing would be different than the way we sing today, they were songs. Nonetheless, and God's people have always been a singing people. From Gregorian chants to today's contemporary worship choruses and songs covering millennia and every kind of music imaginable that has been employed by God's people in different cultures, yes, even jazz and rap. God's people have shared the gospel through music to extol his praises. There's no other major religion in the world that uses music to educate and worship like Christianity. You don't hear too many Muslims or Jewish or Buddhist songs in the top 100. Yet Christianity uses the cultural music of every people group and turns their music into a vehicle of communicating Christian truth. No other religion does it like this. We're a singing people. But for too often, we in Christianity lose our song. That is, we lose the celebratory aspect of Christianity. worship can become pedestrian and rote and perfunctory. Our everyday lives can be the same way. Today, it seems in many evangelical churches that they have forgotten to be a singing people many times. And I've seen this many times when I've visited other churches, maybe when I'm visiting one of my children or we're on vacation and we go to a different church. More and more, I see good evangelical churches and they have a worship team, like we have a worship team, and our worship team, I think, does a marvelous job, and they play songs that are really rich and appropriate. And I stand out in the congregation and I look around and I observe, and non-scientific conclusion here, but from my perspective, if you get 30 or 40% of the people actually singing, that's really good. I see so many people just standing there and not singing. But more and more, we don't participate in it. It's like the worship team is our entertainment for the morning. Now, that's not true here at Berean. This is a singing church here at Berean. We are intentional about that. We desire that you sing. We don't want to overpower the congregation. The worship team, I'm saying. We want the congregation to be heard. We want voices lifted up. We want everybody involved. We are developing at Berean what I call a Berean hymnal. That is a repertoire of songs that are familiar to us. We don't ply you with new songs week after week that you don't know, so you can't sing to it. We sing songs over and over again, songs that you know that can resonate with you, from the old great hymns to the best of the modern worship choruses. We choose songs that are not only theological sound, but musically singable, congregationally singable. Why? Because we want you to sing. We want to lift our voices together in song, and it doesn't matter if you can't carry a tune. One of my best friends in the ministry, Fred Froman, God bless him, man. He's a big old 6'6 dude, weighs over 300 pounds, and here's how he sings. Amazing grace, how sweet the... But boy, he sings. He sings. So we at Berean try to be and we add to our worship hymnal, our Berean hymnal, we add songs slowly and surely. We're building a repertoire. We want you to sing. It's a part of your worship. Well, this is what we find. Christian people have a reason to sing. And the primary reason we have to sing is to praise the chosen servant, Jesus Christ, chapter 42, verse 1. We find in this passage a new song to sing, a reason to sing when we contemplate the comfort of the chosen servant in the first 9 verses of this chapter. The message of the chosen servant. Isaiah then says, let's sing. This is what we're singing about. There's a new song because of who this chosen servant is. Let's sing together. Well, I want to share you through this passage, through these verses 10 through 17, several characteristics of this song. And the first is very obvious. It's a new song. But what does that mean? What does a new song mean? Isaiah was encouraging the captive people in Babylon. Remember now, he's prophesying 150 years, but he's prophesying what's going to happen and how God is going to reclaim his people in the captivity. And so he says, rejoice because God is going to bring you out of captivity, chapter 41. He would bring Cyrus to power, and it would be this self-same Cyrus in chapter 44:28 and 45:1. who would be his shepherd and his anointed to accomplish this. But they would ultimately need to look to a different and better deliverer than Cyrus. He would be the chosen servant of chapter 42, verse 1, who would put all things in order. He will do justice, right? And he would lead gently his people, not as a despot or a dictator as Cyrus was, but a gentle shepherd who would take them by the hand and be a covenant for them. Verse 6. Therefore, because all that is true, sing a new song to the Lord. Music is just such a powerful medium. It is emotional. It is meant to be emotional. I spent the first part of my ministry trying to suppress the emotions of people, right? You don't need emotional in worship because you might go off the deep end, right? Let this rule, right? Don't get into emotions. And over the years, I've moved away from that. Music and poetry that we find in the scripture is inherently emotional. But man, I wanted to suppress it. It was kind of like when this started to dawn on me, it was like we'd be singing a song and it would be like, yeah, it'd be kind of like that. And then it was then maybe it was like this. You know. And then one day it got up over my shoulder, right? And I was actually expressing emotion. Oh my, what has happened to me? Listen, God designs these things. God designs music and poetry to be emotional because that's a part of our being. And that's a part of our worship to Him. Pity the person that can't get emotional over redemption and salvation and resurrection and eternity and forgiveness and all of that. God help us if we can't get emotional about that. That's part of our problem. So it's this powerful medium. I can sing songs from my childhood that are impressed upon the walls of my mind. Sometimes I can't get them out of my mind. They're just there. They embed themselves. You know, I will go home from Sunday worship and spend the afternoon, what have you, in the evening, go to bed at night, and almost invariably, when my head hits the pillow, I will think back to our worship, and I'll start running through my mind one of the songs that we sang during the service. This past week, now today I can't tell you what song it was, but this past week it was like Wednesday or Thursday before I stopped singing that song in the more idle moments of my mind, which were most of the time. But this music is powerful. Songs are powerful. They're meant to be. In modern culture, we're always on the outlook for new songs. Music is so unique that there are virtually limitless combinations of notes and harmonies and words and rhythms. There are always new songs to be written. Some suggest here that we need to think of this new song in the Bible and here in Isaiah 42:10 as being a totally new composition. That being the case, mustn't there be an old song? An old song. What is the old song to which this new song answers? Some commentators say that this old song is the song of Moses in Exodus 15. This is, after all, the first song specifically mentioned in the Bible. It's also referred to at the end of the Bible in Revelation chapter 15:3. So the old song must be the song of Moses, and the new song is one that's different than that song. It's a new song. It's different from the Moses song. Grogan, in Expositor's Commentary, says this: the song is a new one. Before there can be a new, however, there must be an old. And verse 13, recalling perhaps Exodus 15:3-12, suggests that the old song was sung by Israel at its release from Egyptian bondage. If the song is occasioned by the work of the servant, then he is to achieve a new exodus, a great victory over the enemies of God. That fits. And perhaps this is the correct interpretation of this. But that creates a bit of a problem. What do we do with all the other new songs that are in the scripture? I think I give you a list of them up there. Can you turn to that? No, I didn't do it. Rats. I forget to do that sometimes. A number of passages speak of a new song. So I kind of agree with Calvin at this point, who suggests the term new song denotes a category rather than a comparison to a song that has been sung before. This is what Calvin says. By new, he means an excellent, beautiful, and elegant song, not one that is ordinary and common, but a song which may arouse men to admiration as relating to the extraordinary grace of God. New is contrasted with that which is ordinary, and thus he extols the infinite mercy of God, which was to be revealed in Christ, the chosen servant, and which ought therefore to be celebrated and sung with the highest praises. That's kind of where I land. Thus, a new song is a type of song. It is a category of song, not new in relation to a previous song, but new in the sense that it is lofty and spiritual and praiseworthy. It's not a common pedestrian song. It is a high and holy song, and it differs from the mundane garden variety songs of life that the unredeemed sing. It's a metaphor for a new start, a new hope, a new direction, a new life. You see, Judah was singing dirges in the dark in Babylon. In one of the most poignant psalms that you can find, Psalm 137, the author writes, "By the waters of Babylon there, we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. On the willows there, we hung up our lyres." We weren't playing our lyres anymore. There was no song to sing. "But there our captors required of us songs, and our tormentors mirth, saying, 'Sing us one of the songs of Zion.' How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land as we sit here under captivity?" The reason Isaiah was urging upon them a new song was because he was promising them deliverance from captivity. That's the reason to sing. The chosen servant in all his glory in the first 9 verses has accomplished this. Let's sing. Let's sing about it. We're no longer in captivity in battle. We're no longer by the river hanging our harps upon the willow trees. We're taking our harps down, our lyres down, and we're singing a new song. Before I was saved, I sang the old song of the world, a song of sin and self-sovereignty, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. Since being saved, I have sung the new song of praise unto God, a life of intentional obedience and committed service to the King. Now listen, I haven't always been on key. I've hit some sour notes, but it has been a new song. Now, each new song is like this, yet each new song has its own lyrics, its own time signature, its own melody and harmony, and each song of the chosen servant is the song of your life. While being unique and personal, they all fit into the category of a new song, even praise unto our King. Well, the second characteristic of this song is this. It is a universal song. in verse 10a through verse 11, the balance of verse 10 and then verse 11 communicate the fact that Yahweh is not a parochial or a regional deity. He is concerned with the nations. It's one of the fallacies that people harbor about the God of the Old Testament, that he really didn't care for the nations, that he just was there to judge the nations, and he was only concerned with Israel. Well, we saw back in chapters 13 through 35 that wasn't true when we talked about the universality of the gospel and all of the addresses that he gave to all the nations of the world. God was not just a local deity. Here again, Isaiah sounds forth this note to the ends of the earth. That's the NIV translation. Look again, the reference to coastlands in verse 10, which we saw back in chapter 41:1, was referring to the furthest reaches of the populated world. Verse 11 gives the example of desert cities and villages of Kedar and inhabitants of Selah. These regions were well known to Middle Eastern and Near East people as desolate, sparsely populated. It's like if we were reading or writing this passage, we might use Death Valley or the Mojave Desert or the Arctic Circle to make our point that this song is to go to the farthest reaches of the world, even where they're sparsely populated. But it's universal. It's to go out to all people. This indicates that God is telling the nations to sing this song of praise to the Lord. Why? Because God is a missionary God. He has never been unconcerned about the nations. On the contrary, the Abrahamic covenant in Genesis 12 affirms that the promise, whom we now understand to be Jesus Christ, according to Paul in the New Testament, would bless all nations and all peoples. The inclusion of the Gentiles into the commonwealth of God in salvation is peppered throughout the Old Testament. God's call for all people to come to him is manifest in the Old Testament. And all peoples are accountable to him and to the gospel according to Romans 1 and 2. Listen, if you have some idea that there is some kind of legitimacy to the other religions of the world, that simply being a theist, you know, one who believes in a God, some God, that makes you a theist, that's enough, and that's good, that all ideas of God are equal, you are gravely mistaken. I know it is fashionable today to believe that everyone's God, everyone's religion is essentially the same, and all roads lead to heaven. If you believe that, you've not been reading the Bible. The God of the Bible is completely unique and singular. He is the exclusive God, the only God, and variations of him are nothing but idols. We were considering a young man to be one of our missionaries, and it came back to us that he was going to Muslim people, and it came back to us that he was teaching that the God of the Muslims, of Islam, was the same God that we worship. They just have some different idea, but it's the same God. That's wrong. The God of the Bible is unique. The God of Islam is a different God. And if I was in the right country right now, I'd be shot for saying this. I'd be shot for saying that this God, that the God of Islam is an idol. It's not the living God. It's a different God. Who wants that message to be preached to them? Well, nobody, except those who know the truth of the Scripture. Furthermore, Jesus Christ is the only way to this God. John 14:6. So here in Isaiah 42, Jesus, the chosen servant who brings people God's justice, who brings them light, who brings them sight and freedom from prison, he is the only one who can do this. one God. But here's the good news. Here's the good news. He invites the ends of the earth to sing this new song of the chosen servant, Jesus Christ. They can do so by repentant faith in him. This song is a universal song to be sung to every corner of the globe. So the first characteristic of this song is that it was new. The second is that it is universal. The third is its content is ascriptive glory through praise, verses 12 through 17. Verse 12 begins to identify what the nations are called to sing in this new song, glory to God and praise to his name. We can call this the glory slash praise combination, or we can perhaps give it another name and simply call it ascriptive glory. Technically, we don't give glory to God. God is pure glory. We don't add to his glory. We don't increase his glory. What we do is ascribe to him, recognize his glory, affirm his glory, proclaim his glory. But we don't give him glory in the sense of adding to or increasing his glory. So the idea here is that we ascribe glory to him via the praise we give to him. This is the glory-praise dynamic at work. For what then do we give him this ascriptive glory through our praise? Three elements. First of all, for his conquering power. Verses 13 and 15. Here, the chosen servant is likened to a soldier who's preparing for battle. He is said to stir up his zeal, cry out and shout aloud. It's kind of reminiscent of a football players or MAA fighters, cage fighters, you know, who are getting ready to go into battle. They're pounding their chest and they're seething and they're getting their zeal worked up to go into battle. I remember one day in football in high school, our coach had, we weren't doing well in practice, and so he says, okay, now we're gonna do these one-on-one drills. And we all hated it because it was just a painful thing. It was a tackling drill where one guy would get down, another guy, and you'd have two dummies set up here, and you had to go through the chute. And I was so mad because we were being punished. I was seething. And when we used to go down in our stance, we used to have to say, hit, right? When you go down, you say, everybody, when you get down to your stance, you say, hit. And so I got down to my stance, and I said, hit! And I was seething. And he blew the whistle, and the guy across from me, I went out, and the guy jumped outside of the boundary, and I missed him like that. And the coach made him do it again. But that's what athletes do, right? That's what warriors do. They pound their chest. They get themselves worked up. They get the adrenaline flowing. Well, that's kind of the picture here that we have. Those who embrace the chosen servant must also embrace him as the mighty man, like a man of war who shows himself mighty against his foe. We must give him ascriptive glory for this. For if he did not go out against his foes in judgment, he would neither be holy nor powerful to overcome evil. We must give him ascriptive glory for the mighty man of war that he is. That's talking about Jesus here. He's talking about the chosen servant. However, linked with this is the second element of his person for which we give him ascriptive glory. We give him glory for his restraint. Look at verse 14. For a long time, I have held my peace. I have kept still and restrained myself. even though Jesus is a mighty man of war who will level the mountains and dry up the pools when he judges, he is also a patient, long-suffering God who in his mercy practices restraint. Have you ever wondered at the fact that God does not come down hard and immediately upon sinful people? Frankly, I'm surprised America has not seen more of his overt judgment. How depraved can we become as a nation so privileged and blessed by God before we feel the withdrawal of his mercy? How many more babies must be aborted? How much more mockery and derision must be endured? How much longer will God restrain his retribution? People who talk and mock the account of the flood in Genesis 6, 7, and 8, they speak of it in terms of God saying on Tuesday, repent and turn or you will die. And then on Wednesday, he brings the flood. Oh, no. Noah preached the gospel for 120 years to these people. God restrained his judgment for 120 years. The question should not be, how could God judge the entire earth? The question ought to be, how could he have restrained himself for 120 years to give the opportunity for repentance? We ought to praise him for his restraint. We ought to praise him every day that his judgment does not come down upon us because we are shielded by Jesus Christ. Well, the nations should be grateful. God likens his restraint to a woman in labor who shows as much restraint as possible until the contractions cause her to cry out and gasp and pant. This would certainly be true in the days before medical remediation of pain and all of that. When Michelle was laboring with our first child, Evan, she was very quietly breathing through her contractions, and there was another person with her in the labor room who was just screaming bloody murder. It was so bad that an old sergeant of a nurse came in and sternly said, "Stop it! There's no reason to be screaming like this. Settle down!" And I told her I was very sorry and that I would keep it down from now on. But there comes a point during delivery that normally a woman, again, before remediation, begins to cry out and pant and gasp, and she can't hold it back any longer. God is saying, look, I've been very patient. I've restrained my judgment, but just like a woman giving birth who comes to the point of crying out when her delivery draws near, so I'm going to come to the point where I can't hold back any more. It is then that verse 15, it is only then that verse 15 describes him as laying waste the mountains and stripping the vegetation from the land and drying up the waters when he acts against his foes. He will hold it back as long as he can. Just like a woman delivering a baby, that baby is going to come sooner or later. And this should be a cause for ascriptive praise. Instead of condemning and mocking God and indicting God for being a just judge, we should be thanking and praising God for his restraint. Here's a third element of his person for which we give him ascriptive glory: for his new path. Verses 16 and 17. Again, the great mercy of God in the chosen servant shines through. Even though, like a laboring woman must at the point of delivery cry out and pant and gasp, the chosen servant will have to deliver judgment. He restrains as long as possible, but eventually he must mete out judgment. But see the grace of God here in verse 16. For those who turn to me, I will, quote, lead the blind in paths they have not known. I will guide them. I will turn darkness into light and turn the rough places to level ground. Verse 16. There's a new path to deliverance from what? From the idols of verse 17, the idols of our heart. There's a path that leads away from judgment, a path that is leveled out by the chosen servant, a path that is light and not darkness. It is the way of the chosen servant. It is the way of the master. It is the way of forgiveness and freedom from idols to glorify, praise, and serve the living God. Sometimes you just have to sing. Some things call for a song. What we found in chapter 40 and 41 and in chapter 42, verses 1 through 9, about the chosen servant should induce us to a song. It's a new song. It's a new life. It's a new perspective. It's a new worldview. It's a universal song. It is cast out and thrust out to all people. And he creates for those who sing that new song a new path, a new way. Are you singing this kind of song today? Let me close with a couple of points to ponder. Perhaps even now you are singing dirges in the dark. You are even now in the Babylonian captivity to sin, and the only song you can sing is the world's song of sin and guilt and despair and isolation. You need a new song. That song is only sung by those who have been set free from their captivity through faith in Jesus Christ and what he did on Calvary to secure forgiveness of sin for all who would humbly believe and trust in him for salvation. And you know what? If you do that, he will give you a new song. It's a song of deliverance, a song of salvation, a song of praise unto the Lord. It is a high and lofty song that can only be sung by the redeemed. Now, the unsaved of the world, especially the religious types, they try to lip sync that song. How many of you remember Milli Vanilli? Right? Remember the big deal with them? They were found to be lip syncing their songs was supposed to be live concerts. Right? It really cost them their career. They tried to fake it until they make it. Well, many people are trying to lip sync the new song of salvation. You know, they've heard the lyrics. They assume the posture, but they're really faking it. They're lip syncing someone else's song. It is not the real thing. You cannot lip sync your way to heaven. You need a new song, a whole other category of song, an original song you personally sing, a song of repentance and faith in the Lord Jesus. He will give you that song if you will turn to him in faith. But a second point to ponder is this. Perhaps your new song has started to be played in a minor key. Perhaps you are here today as a genuine believer who has been given a new song through faith in Jesus Christ, but things have kind of gone sideways in your life. Sin, apathy in your life has perhaps deadened the new song of salvation. You're not quite hitting the high notes that you used to hit. Your voice has become a little scratchy and a little hoarse. Perhaps the new song's just not in your playlist right now. We've all had the experience of hearing a song for the first time, and it's new and it's fresh and it's exciting and it reaches us, and we put it in our playlist and we listen to it over and over again, and then it gets a little stale. We don't listen to it as much, and then eventually it kind of falls off our playlist. Living apart from constant communion with Jesus and his people is like the new song falling off our playlist. I can describe these people to you. They were once excited and dedicated to Jesus Christ. They perhaps grew up in the church and were there whenever the doors were open. They served God and his people actively. Their lives were centered in Jesus Christ and the church. They were consistently in the Bible and prayer personally. But then, slowly, perhaps, their interest in spiritual things began to wane. Their presence among God's people began to flag. They began to give up their service in the church, dropping off committees and ministry responsibilities, stopped attending small group. That's when the elders and others began to ask each other, "Has anyone seen so-and-so lately?" You know, every elders meeting, we have a section we call soul care, where we go over the congregation and we deal with the concerns that we have in the congregation or personal concerns that people have. It's called our soul care. And invariably, one of us will ask the question, "Has anybody seen so-and-so lately?" They used to be ubiquitous. They used to be everywhere. They used to be, "Has anybody seen so-and-so lately?" Look, I've seen this happen over and over in my 44 years of ministry, and you can say all that you want, that church attendance is really not all that important. All that's important is that I know I'm saved, and I know and church is not that big a deal. But I'm here to tell you that the first indication of spiritual apathy and atrophy is when people begin to forsake the assembling of themselves together. What has happened to these people? They've stopped singing the new song. It's grown old and stale and pedestrian. That song does not move them. It does not grab them as it once did. It has fallen off their playlist. Well, like the prodigal of old, you need to run back to your Father. You need to come to yourself. That is, you need to come to your spiritual senses and realize there is more than enough in your Father's house to feed your soul and house your spirit and give you warmth. But you must start to sing the new song again. It is the song that once set you free and allowed you to soar in Christ. It's still there. It's somewhere in your playlist, but you have to dial it up. Won't you do that today in repentance and loving obedience to the one who wrote that song in you? Regain the celebratory aspect of your Christianity and start singing again. Please stand and receive this benediction. Father, help us to sing this new song, even the song of praise unto our God. For those who do not yet have that song, save them today, Lord, through repentant faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. For those whose song has gone silent, may they once again find that new song, that their hearts might be stirred once again to love and serve the living God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. And amen. We're dismissed.